Hi, I'm Angel, and you won't believe what I found when I got stuck in my ex's closet. This is the story about a nightmare, and the best advice I can give you after this heartbreaking experience is never trust a guy with a Polaroid, especially one that freaks out at the sole mention of social media. I met Nick at a party at my friend Betty's house. He was the hottest guy, and every girl was staring at him. I asked my friend who he was, but she said she had no idea. I never imagined he would come over to talk to me, much less that he'd ask me out. I was so excited that before I even said yes, I stepped on his toe by accident and slipped. I was so embarrassed, but he just laughed. At first, everything was great. He called me all the time. We talked for hours. He had a Polaroid camera and took a lot of pictures with it. We had fun with that. He took amazing pictures, like a pro. But one day, when I tried to upload one of the pictures to my social networks, he stopped me sharply and told me to never do it again, that he didn't like social networks. I thought that was a bit weird. I mean, who doesn't have Instagram these days? But he said he was too shy for it. He didn't even want to hang out with my friends. And after a while, he said he didn't want me to hang out with my friends either. I didn't like that very much, but I had such a great time with him that eventually I started to see him more than my friends. I even got to the point where I didn't see anyone other than him. One day, I saw him checking my cell phone. When I asked him what he was doing, he said he was checking if what I said about the night before was true. My granny was ill and I had to take care of her. I didn't have anything to hide from him, but I thought his attitude was rude. After that, things escalated fast. He called me every night and every morning. He wanted to know what I was doing at all times, even at midday during school. And if I didn't answer the phone, he'd get mad at me. One day, he picked me up to go to the movies, and when I came outside, he said he didn't like my skirt, that it was too short. He said, "Why do you want to show your legs in public? I've already seen them." No reason or explanation was good enough for him. I didn't want him to be mad at me. He'd become the most important person in my life. My friends stopped talking to me or adding me to their plans as my answers were more and more refusals. When Nick came to pick me up at school, I had to rush to meet him because he'd go crazy if I'd made him wait. Eventually, I started dreaming that my phone would crash, so I had a reason not to talk to him. But on the other hand, I needed him to call me, to talk to me, to think about me. He'd somehow managed to make my whole life revolve around him. I was his prisoner. One day, for no good reason, Nick disappeared from my life. The night before, we argued about something that was so lame, I can't even remember it. And he said he was disappointed and left. Since he didn't go to my school and he wasn't on social networks, I had no idea where he was. I called him several times, but he didn't answer. As the day moved forward, my anxiety rose. I was so used to his messages that I got obsessed with my phone, checking it every 5 seconds. I began to sweat as school day was coming to an end. I hoped I'd see him in the parking lot waiting for me, but it never happened. I suddenly realized how alone I was. I saw my old friends hanging out and leaving school together. I waited and waited for Nick until the parking lot was empty. Where was he? I couldn't go home. I couldn't think. I was going mad. I had to see him. I had to know what was going on. I went to his home, but his car was not there. The house looked empty. I hid behind a tree and waited, but sooner than later, my anxiety won. We never stayed much at his home, and he never let me inside his room. He always said it was too messy. I used to have a degree of curiosity about his room, but now it had turned to obsession. So I climbed to his bedroom window and sneaked in. I was shocked to see that the room was very clean. The bed was military made without a single wrinkle. I opened the desk drawers, but they were empty. I looked under the bed, but found nothing. No shoes, no forgotten socks. Even the shelves were empty, as if he'd just moved in. What the hell? Who lives like this? I opened the closet and found my answer. A psycho. A creep. Piled up on endless shelves were boxes and more boxes, and were neatly distributed. And they had names on it. All women's names. Close to the door, I saw one that said Angel and freaked out. I opened it, and inside, I found hundreds of Polaroid pictures, the ones he'd taken in all our dates together. It would have been a nice gesture if I hadn't seen all the other boxes inside the closet. I stood petrified for a moment with the box in my hand. To make things worse, I found a folded paper inside the box, and when I opened it, I almost fainted. It was a list of events, and beside each one, a marked box. First date, check. First movie night, check. It went on like that, and I realized he had planned everything, even the bad days. Have a fight, check. Make her jealous, check. Nothing had ever been spontaneous with Nick. At the end of the list, I read, breakup, check. What? Disappearing from my life was his way of breaking up with me? Hell no. I changed my life upside down for you, and this is how you repay me? I grabbed my box, and as I was about to leave, a wind shut the door and I got locked inside. A moment later, I heard noises. Someone was there. A phone rang, and when he answered, I realized it was Nick. He said he'd be out in a second, and I froze, praying he didn't open the closet. And then he was gone. I forced the closet door and it opened. I looked outside the window and saw him walking towards his car. And when I looked closely, I saw another woman in the passenger seat. I got immediately jealous, but suddenly realized that the woman was Betty, my old best friend. I rushed back into the closet and started reading the names on the boxes until I found the one I was looking for. Inside Betty's box, there were a few Polaroids already and a folded paper just like mine. I opened it with trembling hands and read that a few boxes were already checked. They'd already had the first two dates and movie night was next. I put everything back inside the box and left both in the closet. I was afraid he'd notice. I went back down through the window and rushed to the movie theater in an Uber. I didn't exactly know what I was going to tell them, but I had to face him and warn her. I arrived and waited for them hiding in the bar across the street. When they arrived, I stood up, decided, and walked straight towards them. Nick was shocked to see me, and I used that to my advantage. I called him a psycho and yelled at him in front of everyone. Betty was stunned as she heard me but stood silent. He quickly looked at her and told her I was the crazy ex-girlfriend he was telling her about. Betty looked at both of us and then called me jealous and selfish. It broke my heart. She used this opportunity to tell me that I left her alone and now she was dating. She wasn't entirely wrong, I have to admit, but her words were like spears to my chest. I've been so blind for so long, and I realized how much I've missed her all this time. I told her, I don't care if you want to date a guy and never talk to me again. Just not with him, please. He's a creep. Before she could say anything, the waiter from the bar came and told me I'd left without paying, and Nick took that to his advantage. He said I was not only crazy, but a thief too, in front of everyone on the street. I was so ashamed. Betty denied in silence. Nick put a hand across her waist, and they went inside the theater. I was left there alone, again, all the judging glares set on me. Why didn't I take the boxes? They were the only proof. Betty was as blind as I had been, and I needed to save her. Think fast. It was now or never. I rushed back to Nick's home, knowing he wouldn't be back for at least 2 hours, and climbed into his room again. I still couldn't believe how many boxes were in the closet. I took my box and Betty's. When I came out, Nick's mother was in the hallway and saw me. She got inside the room and asked me what I was doing there. I told her she had a psycho son and pushed her out of the way. And as I was going down the stairs, I shouted, "Look inside the closet!" I hoped she found everything and did something about Nick, but he was not my problem anymore. My focus was set on Betty. I've been a bad friend, and I owed her this much. So I went to her house and waited for her there, hiding. When they arrived, I heard Nick telling her the same lies he told me. I wanted to punch him in the face. Before they could get inside her house, I stepped in their way. He said, "What are you doing here?" "Shut up," I answered with a determination I didn't know I had. I looked at Betty. With tears in my eyes, I said, "I'm sorry." And when I took out the box with her name on it, Nick freaked out and shouted, "Where did you get that?" "From your closet, you freaking psycho." Betty looked at us like a tennis match. She tried to open the box, but Nick stopped her violently. I was about to jump over him and finally punch him in the face, but the box flew into the air as Betty struggled to release her arm, and all the pictures fell slowly to the ground like feathers. Betty looked at them one by one in shock, and then I showed her the list. And when she read it, she started crying. After a second, we looked up and Nick was gone. He was inside his car and already leaving. At first, Betty got mad at me for ruining her life, but when I showed her my box, she understood how much more damage he'd done to me. I stayed over her house that night, like old times. I told her everything about the psycho Nick, and she said she couldn't believe how precise his plans were. She thanked me for opening her eyes, and then I thought that something had to be done. How many other girls were in danger? So, the next morning, we went straight to the police with our boxes. We explained everything to the detective, and with our testimonies and the proof we had, it was enough to get a search warrant. When they arrived at Nick's home, he was already gone. They went to his room and opened the closet. Nick's mother started to cry as she realized how sick her son was. The police took away all the boxes as evidence and immediately released a statement to every media for his arrest. He was already on the outskirts of town when the police found him. They arrested him for stalking a lot of girls. Not to mention, he had a criminal record long before this. Luckily, Betty and I did something about this creep. He'd already done a lot of damage to a lot of girls, and he would have continued if we hadn't stopped him. If you see or live something like this, don't stay silent. Speak up, for it takes all of us to take care of each other.